Jesus, we come before you and we thank you. We thank you that, Lord, you are the great, good, gracious, and glorious God who watches over us, who has invited us to be children, your children, God. So, Lord, we ask you that even during this time that you would meet us where we are, but please don't leave us where we are. Transform us. Let us be able to behold your glory through your word. And Lord, transform us from one degree of glory to another. Lord, we are able to say with John, apart from you, we can do nothing. But with you, God, we can continue, Lord, to walk in love, to walk as the light of the world, and Lord, to continue to fill, to be fruitful and multiply and fill this earth with your goodness, God. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Let me ask you to take a seat. I want to welcome you today. Thank you so much for coming and worshiping with us this morning. Some of you who might not know me, my name is Raphael, and I am privileged to be the lead pastor here at City Church. If you have your Bibles, open to Ephesians chapter 5, Ephesians chapter 5 verse 1, we are looking at 21 verses today, so help us God. I'm going to start by reading Ephesians 5 verse 1, and it says, Therefore, just considering everything that has happened from chapter 1 to chapter 4, where you have seen that you are adopted by God, God has set his eyes on you, Ephesians 1, Jesus has come to redeem you, and the Spirit has sealed you, and you were dead in sin, now you have been resurrected through Christ, and now, not only that, now Jews and Gentiles have now been reconciled to be one new man, Christ has destroyed the walls of hostility, and then, now we can now be able to come, all of us, and cry out, and bow our knees before God the Father, from whom every family in the world comes from, and then now we're able to look, and after what we've all seen, a new heart is now meant to have a new way of life, where we are asked to put off our old self and put on Christ. And so here, now Paul is going to say, therefore, in consideration of all this, be imitators of God as dearly loved children. And I probably am going to camp here a little bit, because unless we understand this statement here, everything else falls apart in Christianity. And so a lot of people have been sending me questions. Hey, what do I respond like during these days? How can I respond? And I say, like, really, at the end of the day, I would say if we understood this verse here, we wouldn't have to be asking, what do I need to do? Be imitators of God. And so and so, if we were to actually now begin to say, what does it look like to imitate God? It would be like, love as God has loved, walk in love as God has shown his love towards us. It would be walk in the light, expose every darkness, and then also continually be filled with the Spirit, which is what this passage is going to help us with. One of the things that happened in my house, and I know if you're a parent, this always becomes a wonder to you, is when I watch my sons. And so there's this love that I have for my shoes, that I like to keep them in a box. This is like, if you've ever owned a pair of Jordans, I like to keep them in a box. I take all the stuff that they stuff it with when you buy it, and I put them back in the box and stuff like that. But my sons always make sure, before I do that, Like now, I don't even need to put them in there anymore because my sons have made sure that they literally do whatever what I've hated on my shoes. So as soon as I take them off, the other day my son ran into my room, looked at me straight in the face, took my shoes, and literally smiled back at me. And then I saw him put his feet inside my shoes. Everything within me was screaming, no. And then I saw him literally crumple them. I saw creases showing up on my shoes, and I was like, that's it. But part of me started to wonder, what is it about children that they just love to run and put on their daddy's shoes? I love my hats, and I like them staying flat. And not only that, as soon as I wear my hat, I take it, fold it nicely, put it away. And like my son always, as soon as I put it down, like right now it's Liam's obsession. As soon, even if it's brand new, he will go and he will put it on. But the problem that I have is that I'm okay with you putting it on. After that, he gets distracted. He sees a toy and he takes it off and throws it on the ground. And I'm like, no. Usually I'm diving trying to get that hat so that it doesn't hit the floor. But this is one thing that I love. I love the fact that this scripture begins to say that one of the reasons why if we have meditated on the love of God, all of a sudden it becomes a delight to begin to imitate God. So really at the end of the day here, Paul is going to say, be imitators of God as dearly loved children. And I think then, really, at the end of the day, this is what sets Christianity apart from every single religion. It's the fact that we are people that respond from the love that we have received. Anytime you see any type of hostility, it's because we have lost sight. We have not camped here as dearly loved children. As dearly loved children. And so imitating God flows out from our understanding his love for us. And if, in fact, there's a huge difference, and this is what religion is, there's a huge difference between actions of a loved son and actions of a son seeking to be loved. Two different sides. And so understanding who we are determines what we do. We first of all understand who we are. And in Ephesians, it's going to help us to see our identity is that we are loved. God set his eyes on us. He predestined us to be what? To be adopted as sons. God set his love and he sent Jesus to come and rescue us. And then after that, he put his spirit in us and he sealed us. And then not only that, we know that he came when we wanted nothing to do with him. He came, he raised us up from the dead. And so we continue to meditate in his love. In fact, Ephesians chapter 3 is going to help us. And he's going to say in Ephesians, Paul is going to pray. And he says, one thing I want you to actually have, I want you to stand at the top. At the top of everything and gaze into God's love. I want you to comprehend with all the saints what is the length and what is the width, and then what is the height and the depth of God's love. Because once you get a hold of that, everything changes. Everything changes. In fact, what's going to be affected there is that your walk is going to change because of what you have beheld, right? And I love those words. What is depth, right? As loved children, if you gaze into God's love, especially Romans 5:8 is going to say, but God demonstrates his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us, right? And if you gaze, what is the pinnacle of the place where you go and gaze at God's love? Go and look at the cross. The highest demonstration of his love for us. You know what you're going to see there? You're going to see the depth of his love. A love so greater than the grave or the sea, reaching down to the lowest degrees of our sin, to the most depraved soul and coming and rescuing us there. And when you see that, all of a sudden, grace becomes amazing grace because he saves wretches like us. What about the breadth? reaching over the whole world, across all races and all classes and all mankind. All of a sudden, then you don't have to be trying to figure out then how do I respond. Gaze in God's love, and then you will see what his heartbeat is like. And then if you are gazing at God's love, go to Revelation. After that, I saw people from every nation, every tribe, every tongue. Then you will be able to see that Christ has destroyed these walls of hostility, and he has created one new man in Jesus. Therefore, all of a sudden, we're not trying to rescue anything. We are saying we are going to stand and we're going to love who Christ has loved. Gazing in God's love helps us to become imitators of him. And we begin to love those who our society says we should hate. What about the length, right? Reaching from eternity to eternity, from life's first cry to our final breath. What does that like? And as soon as we begin to love him and imitate and watch him and who and where his love stops, all of a sudden you get to see this part of like, man, listen. This is what it means. What it means to love others. Because listen, before I was formed in the womb, he loved me. And not only that, after that, this is eternal life. He died so that he could restore me. No matter how bad I was, like the sinner at the cross, he still said, today you will be with me, rejoicing with me, enjoying my presence in eternity. That's the length of his love. That is mind-blowing. And then after that, imitate, just look at that. And then after that, it's easy to imitate. What about the height? Reaching from up to the throne of God, the height in which the redeemed are destined to be exalted. This is what the Bible says, that he has raised us up and seated us, what? In the heavenly places with him. Right, we're seated next to him. This is what literally, if you want to kind of look at what was when he was creating, he said, let us create man in our image, and right, and it, so he's going to image us. But at the same time, if you read Psalm 8, it says you have crowned man with what? Your glory. And at the resurrection, he raises us up and we are seated with him. I would say what is our duty as human beings is to, first of all, we get caught up on, we want to imitate. But I would say in order for us to imitate, we need, first of all, drench ourselves in his love for us. As dearly loved children. If we can do that, all of a sudden, things become very easy. Right, to know this love of Christ that surpasses all knowledge. Herein is the wonder of wonders, the greatest wonder. We can look at all the wonders of the world. Here is the wonder, this love that surpasses knowledge. Right, and then one from there, then we begin to move forward. When we do that, it's easy now then to begin to imitate God by doing what? By walking in love. Look at verse 2. Therefore, be imitators of God as dearly loved children, and walk in love as Christ also loved us. You see what's happening here? Imitate as Christ. And so what you're going to see, imitate this invisible God. But how do we imitate this invisible God? Come down and let's look at how God came into history. And then let's watch Christ. In fact, let's read the life and the times of Christ. Let's look at who he is and what has he done in his life. And let's look who Christ, who also loved us. And what does he do? He climbs up the cross, gave himself up for us, a sacrificial and fragrant offering to God. I love this. Because then we begin to say, what does walking in love look like? Walking in love looks like giving your rights for another, giving up your rights for another, laying down your life, becoming a servant, right? And a servant of all, loving all, and literally imitating. And then it says this, when we imitate Christ in his life, love to everyone, all of a sudden we become like him and we become this sacrificial, fragrant offering to God. What does it look like? And this is the glory that God wants to be happening in the church. What does it look like when we become a fragrant offering to God? It's when we become to love, when we begin to love one another as Christ has loved us. Right? That's why we always say, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you forward for the glory of God. And here Paul is going to give us a little summary of things that, a little summary, but yet really there is more that could be piled on to here. Look at verse 3. He says, as God's child, there are some things that we obviously need to begin to avoid. If we're going to imitate him, it says, but sexual immorality and any impurity, look at this, or greed should not even be heard from amongst you. I love, if you can underline a passage there, a phrase, it's like, should not be heard of amongst you. And the fact that there are some things that are going to be very easy to expel as soon as we look and gaze on who God is. This is why God was going to call David a man after his heart. Because David is going to say in Psalm 27, one thing that I desire, and that this is what I'm going to seek after, that I may just dwell in your house and gaze upon your beauty. Like, as soon as I see that, there are some things that all of a sudden, if I want to really love, as a loved person, there are some things that automatically I want to just get rid of. And here Paul is going to say, well, what is it? Immorality, replace immorality, sexual immorality with faithfulness. Begin to now conform with how God designed things. Replace any impurity with purity, because I want to walk and I want to just begin to imitate him. I want to put on his shoes. And then not only that, all of a sudden I'm expelling greed, right? Because these are things that, and look at this. I love this next phrase, as is proper for saints. As is proper. All of a sudden, I begin to say, man, this doesn't resemble my father. I want to get rid of it, not because I'm just like, not because of drudgery. Oh, man, like this is, but because I recognize that his love for me is so great. And his love for me has become a great treasure that all other loves are falling into line. Right? Look at what other examples. It says, obscene and foolish talking or crude joking are not suitable, but rather giving thanks. It's pretty interesting because every single time I see these verses are actually put, usually they are quoted apart from as loved children. Because I think everything becomes so easy to, as in like, man, you want me to change the way I talk? You know what? Because I want to hang out with you, God, more. Like, my speech is just going to change because I'm beholding your glory. And everything else becomes like, everything else doesn't, I just like put it down. Look at this. And I love this, but rather giving thanks. My life now is characterized as a life of doxology. Everything has to be, I want to thank God. For know and recognize this, even sexually immoral and impure and greedy people, who is an idolater, does not have an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Let no one deceive you with empty arguments, for God's wrath is coming on the disobedient because of these things. Therefore, do not become their partners. I love this because everything here, and he's saying that, if you see these things operational in your life, begin to question whether am I his child? Now, love, he brings this. It says this person does not have an inheritance in the kingdom of Christ and of God. Simply meaning that if you see something else, that's like begin to get alarmed in you and begin to go before God. That's why now the Christian life needs to be a life of constantly putting off and putting on Christ. Begin to repent if you find yourself no longer having these things that are imitating God. And then why? Because this is actually what shows you that you are his child. That for you, what you treasure most is this inheritance. What is that inheritance? It's the fact that God, in Christ, God has given you himself. And that's your greatest inheritance. And so therefore, this is the centerpiece to my house. Everything else is going to go. And it's everything else is going to go. And it's going to say that all of a sudden it changes your partnerships in life, right? It changes your partnerships. It changes everything. Why? Because me as a person, according to Ephesians chapter 2:10, for we are his workmanship created in Christ for good works, right? For God prepared ahead of time. This is who we are. We begin to say, I am God's workmanship. He's working in me. And every single time he's chipping away everything that is not of him. Amen. So walk in love, but then also walk in the light. Look at verse 8 and says this, for you were once darkness. That is one of the most scariest verses you could read in scripture. Not you were once in darkness. So now it helps you. It helps you when you watch literally wars, when you see racism, when you see tribalism, and these are things when you see anything, whether it's abortion, whether it's evil running, whether it's terrorism, whether it's whatever it is, it helps you to get to see where were we before Christ came for us. Then it helps us to begin to pray. Listen, there is no hope for us apart from Christ. Who were we? Scripture is not going to say you were in the dark. It says that you were darkness, meaning that you were completely one with darkness. And so therefore you were an instrument of darkness in your thoughts and your deeds. That's like, I was like, no, Paul, like, it's so hard for me to kind of like, I mean, surely there's something good in human beings. Yes, we're created in God's image, but this is how bad this virus had gone into us. It started affecting our desires, our emotions, and everything within us. But listen, if any man is in Christ, he's a new creation. The old is gone, but now you are light in the Lord. Not you're in the light, you are light in the Lord. This is the most hopeful verses you could ever read in scripture. Is there any hope? Is there any hope for anything, any of this evil to? Listen, Christ is our hope. Because in Christ, listen, Christ is the only one who can transfer us from the kingdom of darkness into the kingdom of his Son. Right? Now listen to this, because of that, live as children of the light. For the fruit of the light consists of all goodness. Everything that is good, pursue that. Everything that is righteous, pursue that. Everything that is true, pursue that. That's what you now need to be looking for. And then why? Because now you are a child of the light. Right, light brings in this rich harvest of what is good, what is right, and what is true. Then when lines are being drawn of where you stand, you get to say, I stand where God is standing. I stand for what is good, what is true, and what is light. What is right. I love verse 10. It's going to say, testing what is pleasing to the Lord. This right here talks about in every situation, placing yourself at God's disposal. Listen, placing yourself. This is what, when you wake up every single day, reading scripture, looking to scripture, and praying to God, you are actually saying, God, you're putting yourself and you are disposing yourself to God and examining your heart, your mind, and then so that you can be directed by His word, right? As a Christian, we are called to have this investigative attitude of testing every single day. What is it that's pleasing? What is the will of God in this? And rise up from there and respond to whatever it is that's bothering us. What does God say about this? What does God say about that? Right? And when we do that and we find out what's pleasing before God, and we continually discern from His word. And it says this in verse 11. Don't participate in the fruitless work of darkness. Right? I want to participate in something that's fruitful. What is fruitful? What is good? What is true? And what is right? But then at the same time, there are things that I'm going to begin to avoid. I want to walk like Daddy. I want to walk like my Father. I want to put on His shoes. And this is not actually what is so beautiful about Daddy's shoes. You know what? What's so beautiful about that? It means that you will never arrive. You will never arrive. You always, as you put them on, it's always funny because I watch my son just walking like this because they are so big. But what that simply means is that you're always going to be growing into them. I know that my son is going to grow up one day and wear maybe the same size shoe as me. But for us, with us and God, God's shoes will never be able to fill. That's why we need to be going deep. How deep is your love, God? And then just look around and say, who have I expelled out of your love? Maybe God is able to reach them. How wide is it? Who do I think that God is able to reach? No, He can. How high is it? Who do I think can sit next to you, Jesus? He can. That's why our biggest responsibility is to be responding in prayer more than anything at this moment. Amen? And then look at this. And it says, for it is shameful. Like it says this, like don't participate, but instead expose them. Right, this word expose them, and I love this word. This word expose them, it has these two meanings, rebuking them, but at the same time, reproving them. And then so, rebuking them, it means that stand up, call out what is not right. What is not right, and you just be able to say, no, God doesn't stand for this. But then at the same time, this is actually like where sometimes we end up missing the mark. It's not only just call out, now go and begin to prove it. As in like, this is how it's meant to be done. This is how it's meant to. That's what puts the church in the greatest position at this moment. When there's tribalism happening, right? When I'm saying tribalism at this moment, I'm talking even about the donkey and the elephant getting to sit together at church and loving one another because in Christ we're one, right? I'm just saying like when we're looking at that, I'm looking at everything that divides us. I'm looking at the rich and the poor, right? I'm looking at anything, whether it's racism, I'm looking at whether whatever it is, then there's no one who's exempt. We now begin, how then do we call out against it and then we begin to demonstrate God's heart in it. Right? So it's not enough for us as believers to just avoid some of these things, but then we are to voice against any vile and destructive conduct, but then at the same time we're called to stand up and become become like Christ in our world and demonstrate what it looks like and begin to say, come and follow. We're imitating. What are we doing? We're imitating God's heart. Right? And it says, for it is shameful even to mention what is done by them in secret. Everything exposed by the light is made visible. For what makes everything visible is light. And I love the fact that that light now, you are light, means that that light has finally got to your workplace. you are light, it means that that light is finally gotten to your Thanksgiving table. You are light, it means that that light is now invaded your home, whatever sphere that you find yourself living in. Therefore, it is said, get up, up sleeper. It says the poem, rise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you. I love this because it speaks of the position that we are in as children of God. Where were we? We were darkness. But then we heard his voice, like Lazarus in that tomb. We heard his voice. We were sleeping in our death, and he called us to rise from the dead. And he says, and Christ began to shine on us. And you know what is our goal? Is to become like him. And beholding him, we're constantly being transformed. So when I see a Christian being hateful, I begin to lament and say, do you know how loved you are? I think what you need more of is going and just sitting and gazing in his love. And I think those responses are going to be, probably after that, you're going to see that I shouldn't respond in this way. Right? I love this now. What else are we meant to be doing? Like, continue to look at his love. I love this. Imitators of God. Look at Christ. Imitate Christ. Listen to Christ. Follow him. But then continue to walk in wisdom. So walk in love. Walk in the light, but walk also in wisdom. Look at verse 15. Pay careful attention then how you live. Not as unwise people, but as wise, right? Pay careful attention. Be prepared to respond appropriately in every situation. And how then do you do that? To live this in a wise way. And I like this because it says that making the most of the time because the days are evil. I love this. This is an idiom of making the most of our time. It's actually like continually live with God's urgency in this world. Take full advantage of the privileges that God has put for you. And it says this like, and then look at this. Time is seen as being used for all evil and godless purposes. Use the time wisely, and every single minute of your life, make sure it represents who God is. Right? And how then do we do that? I'm glad you've asked. And then all of a sudden, it's going to begin to say that a Christian needs to continually get drunk, not with things that make people drunk, but they need to go and look at what? As loved children, constantly expose yourself as walk as Christ. Look at the love of Christ. Not only that, continually drench yourself in the Spirit of God. Listen, you've been sealed by him. Be led by the Spirit. Look at this. Don't get drunk with wine, which leads to reckless living, but be filled by the Spirit. Be filled by the Spirit. And the idea here is that, like, it's not so much of, like, it's not so much of what sometimes we've taken it to be, where we're just saying, man, I need to just go get drunk and then literally, like, and chase after spiritual ecstasies. But here, it's actually saying, the idea here is that we're meant to be filled with the influence of this living person, the Holy Spirit. Meaning that every single thing that now, after this, we're meant to, and when we're filled, and in fact, this is one of the imperatives, it's a command, be filled. And it's talking about this ongoing experience, it's a present tense, ongoing experience of God's presence, always filling you. Every single morning you wake up and literally get filled with him, and if anything, just continually opening up your sails and let the Spirit fill your sails up so that you can continually run away from sin and continue to run towards God. Let him continually fill you up. But how do we do that? I'm glad you've asked. As the church, then the Bible's going to begin to say this, speaking to one another in psalms. Begin to speak, read psalms towards one another. Sing with one another. Sing towards one another. And I love this because at the end of the day, you get to see this idea of Christians and singing and reading scripture together and doing all this. You get to see this horizontal effect. As in like, man, there has to be like one of the reasons why we long to be in church is so that we can speak to one another in psalms and spiritual songs and making music from our hearts to the Lord. Right, we sing to one another and we remind each other of God's faithfulness. And not only that, there's this vertical aspect. We sing to the Lord, right, and making melodies to the Lord. And while we're reminding one another, we're singing to the Lord. And then as we're doing that, all of a sudden we're encouraging one another. And then we're also being grateful towards God. And then at the same time, there's this thing that's happening on the inside, this internal aspect, giving thanks always for God, for everything to God the Father, and in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ. All of a sudden, we're filled with this gratefulness, and all of a sudden, darkness gets expelled in us, and then we begin to say, what Christ has fought for, I'm going to fight for. And that's where this last verse comes in. Submitting to one another in the fear of Christ. Submitting to one another in the fear of Christ. All of a sudden, there's this attitude of meekness, gentleness, and humility towards one another. No one is better than the other. Now in this Christian community, there's a willingness to serve, to learn from, and to be corrected by another believer, regardless of sex or age or class or race or whatever, any other division. All of a sudden, out of respect for Christ, we begin to say, you mean more to me. Right? This is actually what? Be imitators of God as loved children. I beg you from this day onwards, every single morning, wake up, climb up to the top of the summit, your most desperate place that you need to be at as a Christian is to gaze at God's love. And then from there, let it actually begin to affect your walk. And begin to walk in love. Walk as a child of the light. And begin to walk in wisdom. And in case you forget, God is going to say there's a way for you to be reminded. Be reminded of his love. Because it's so easy to forget. And that's where we're going to be reminded. Christ left us ordinances to remember those things. In case you forget how much he loves you, this is why 1 Corinthians is going to say, talking about communion, for I received from the Lord what I also passed on to you. On the night when he was betrayed, the Lord took the bread, and when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, this is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me. What are we meant to remember that? How deep his love is for us and how much he's called us to walk as his children. I love this because then he's saying, do this in remembrance of me. He's saying, run into my shoes, my child. Run into my shoes and wear them and then just begin to imitate me. Do this in remembrance of me. I have left my shoes visible for you to go and put them on so that you can remember, right? And then begin to recognize there's more for me to grow into, right? Do this in remembrance of me. In the same way, he also took the cup after supper and said, this cup is a new covenant in my blood, right? Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. For as often as you eat this bread and drink this cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. And then what's that going to do? It's going to remind you of God's love. It's going to remind you of Christ's love towards you. It's going to remind you. And then you're going to be filled with the Spirit. And then all of a sudden, you're going to rise up from there. And then you're going to do what you've been called to do, imitate him. So then, whosoever eats this bread and drinks this cup of the Lord in an unworthy manner will be guilty of sin against the body and the blood of the Lord. Let each person examine himself in this way. Let him eat the bread and drink from the cup. For whosoever eats and drinks this without recognizing the body and eating, and it says eats and drinks judgment on himself. I love this because it's going to say, every time you do this, you need to do it in a worthy manner of saying, okay, I see the lines that have been drawn. Let me examine myself and put off everything else that's not of God. And then that is the worthy manner. But if you don't begin to expel the things that he doesn't love, you're doing it in an unworthy manner. Let me pray for us. Jesus, we come before you and we thank you, God. And even at this moment, as we examine ourselves and as we are about to step over to the tables and begin to partake of the bread and the cup, Lord, remind us once again the role that you have called us to take, even as a church, even in our world that looks like it's burning down, God. Help us, Lord, to behold your love and then the best we know how, rise up from there and begin to imitate you in every way possible. It's in your name we pray. Amen. Let's take some time, just examine yourself, and when you're ready, please step over to the table and then sing with us as we reflect on God's love. Amen.
Christ has paid for every failing, and I am his forevermore. Mine are tears in times of sorrow, darkness not yet understood. Through the valley I must travel, where I see no earthly good. But mine is peace that flows from heaven, and the strength in times of need. I know my pain will not be wasted, Christ complete his work in me. And mine are days here as a stranger, pilgrim on a narrow way. One with Christ I will encounter harm and for his name. But mine is armor for this battle, strong enough to last the war. And he has said he will deliver safely to the golden shore. And mine are keys to Zion City, where beside the King I walk. For them my heart has found its treasure. Christ is mine forevermore. Stand and sing. Come rejoice now, O my soul, for his love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure. Christ is mine forevermore. Come rejoice now, O my soul, for his love is my reward. Fear is gone and hope is sure. Christ is mine forevermore. Come rejoice now, O my soul. The King I walk, for there my heart has found its treasure. Christ is mine forevermore, and mine are keys to Zion City, where beside the King I walk, for there my heart has found its treasure. Christ is mine forevermore. Oh, Christ is mine forevermore. Oh, Christ is mine
stronger than
sins they are many, His mercy is more. What riches of kindness He lavished on us. His blood was a payment, His life was our cause. We stood neath the dead we could never afford. Our sins, they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Darkness new every morn. Our sins they are many, His mercy is more. Praise the Lord, His mercy is more. Sins they are many, His mercy is more. Our sins they are many, His mercy is more.
Before I pray for us, before I send us out, let me just invite you to just kind of see this video. This is one of our mission partners, Mitch, who is in Guatemala, and just want to ask you to be praying for them, praying for them. So it's just like just a minute. Watch this, and then.
Hey, City Church. I'm Mitch, and this is Amanda. We're missionaries, and this is a little boy, Lucas. We're missionaries from the States, and we are also church planners. And I'm a pastor of a rural, remote church in a village in the middle of nowhere, Guatemala. But we wanted to say thank you for your partnership. We're grateful for your church and people like you to help us advance the gospel in the remote parts of Guatemala.
And we just ask that you'd be praying for our church and our church members, because we're in such a remote part of the country. Our church members, they don't have access to computers or internet, so we're unable to not only meet together in person, but we're not able to even do Zoom meetings or anything like that. And so it's been really difficult for our church members not being able to gather and fellowship with one another. So we just ask that you be praying for us, and we of course will be praying for you. And thank you so much.
Thanks, guys.
So as we leave, the offering basket is at the back there. I just wanted to really encourage you and obviously thank you for, it's because of your giving and your faithfulness that we're able to, as City Church, like I'm always just wanting, as we're looking at this and wanting to imitate God, I always like want us to imitate Him even in a way that we're taking part. This church is in Guatemala. Like, I wish you could see where it is and what they're doing. God is doing amazing things, and we're taking part of that, in that. And so, and usually it's also through our giving that we're able to commit to Mitch and his wife every single month. So I wanted to show you that because it's good for you to see, even as we encourage you to give, to see what we are doing as well as a church. So so the box is at the back, just as a reminder of as we live to give. And then let me just read, I'm going to read Romans chapter 15 as our doxology. So read with me. May the God of endurance and encouragement, Grant you to live in such harmony with one another, in accord with Christ Jesus, that together you may with one voice glorify the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ. Therefore, welcome one another as Christ has welcomed you for the glory of God. God bless you. Have an amazing week.